On that day, Lyon, a Republican city but not a Jacobin one, surrendered to the government army after a three-week siege. Georges Couthon was sent by the Committee of Public Safety to root out those who had opposed Jacobin rule. "I will teach the people of Lyon the alphabet," he threatened. But in practice, he was lenient, blaming the unrest in the city not on subversion, but on its peculiar climate.
It takes on almost a racial quality. Couthon himself remarks that there's something in the air, the fog that comes off the river seems to addle the brains of the Lyonnais.
"I know, Lyon. The fogs are no worse than Paris."
"It's a ridiculous theory."
"Couthon is just making excuses, and he's too slow. Kings punish slowly because they are weak and they are cruel. Republics are swift and exacting."
"I agree. We are making too many laws and too few examples. We are punishing only obvious crimes. The way to frighten waverers is to come down hard on small offences."
"George is too kind."
"He wants the palm, but not the dust."
"I would evacuate the whole city. Those who cannot be saved should be killed quickly. Those who can should be spread out through France, where they can acquire a republican education through watching others." "You are too philosophical to let the idea escape you."
"We can be humane after final victory."
He basically pronounces the death sentence of Lyon for the crime of having defied the Paris, defied the Republic, having made war on liberty, as the words of the official decree go. And Lyon will be eradicated. In the column that they go forward to erect says, "Lyon made war on liberty, Lyon is no more."
It now fell to Couthon to fulfil the committee's wish and to begin the process of demolishing the entire city.
Not long after the fall of Lyon, Couthon holds a ceremony to begin the process of punishing the city. He's carried ceremoniously by sans-culottes to the Place Bellecour, which is the swish neighbourhood of Lyon. They knock down over 1,000 houses, many of which are sort of very large, grand townhouses that have been built up in the previous decades.
Back in Paris, Saint-Just gave the terror a further unexpected twist. All French citizens who heard his speech knew that new levels of republican enthusiasm were now being demanded.
"It would be good to rule by the laws of peace and natural justice. These laws are good among the friends of liberty. But between the people and its enemies, there is nothing in common but the sword. We must govern by iron those who will not be governed by justice."
It's very classical, it's very republican, it's very Roman, it's very Spartan. And those are the models that he's thinking of when he says these kind of things. To be a warrior is more or less the same thing. And, you know, you can be a warrior under arms or you can be a warrior in the economy. But if you're not being a warrior in some sense, you're not really being a citizen. And that does effectively, you know, in the ancient Greek world, as in the 18th century, make you an enemy of the state.
"We must punish not only the traitors, but also those who are neutral. You have to punish whoever is passive in the Republic and does nothing for it. For since the French people has declared its will, everyone who is opposed to it is outside the sovereign body. And everyone who is outside the sovereign body is an enemy."
What a horrible speech. What an imbecilic, illogic, depraved thing to say. Enforcement of truth is no business of the state. You can persuade all you like,
But you and you can deplore the failure to hate your enemies, but you can absolutely deplore it, but you can never, ever, ever make it a crime.
This may sound totalitarian, but I think there is a moment of truth in it. To say I want to stay out is violently to take sides. I will give you a shocking comparison. You know that Mahatma Gandhi, an anti-Jacobin, if there ever is one, says in some of his writing the same thing. The lesson is, in a really tough situation of choice, there is no neutral position. You have to take sides. Not taking sides is already taking sides.
But for Sanchez, before 89, he was a schoolboy. He's irreproachable. He'd never had to compromise because he'd never encountered the compromises that real life demands. And I think when you look at Saint-Just in particular, you see someone who's stuck in adolescent posturing. He's the classic rebellious teenager who's not that long out of his teenage years. And he's playing out his own psychological battles. But suddenly he's playing this game with the lives of thousands of people. The revolution is allowing him to play it out on a mass scale.
We need to purge the army again.
Someone couldn't bear to part with their glorious past.
Of course, I don't think they could see him like that. It's hard for us to realise what people at the time found so impressive about him. We think, why didn't they just call his bluff and say, sit down, child.
Ah, purge, purge. Whose turn is it this week to be general? Give this fellow a go. He's an honest man, good to his friends, a sincere Republican. He has all the credentials to captain the army. Can you make it to Belgium by tonight, citizen?
Just get out, get out. Go on, get out now!
There's a very clear sense in which they blame officers for their troops' shortcomings, and by late 1793, they have, I think, a couple of dozen general officers in prison, most of whom will be executed by the end of the year. They have a very clear policy of running the upper echelons of the army by fear.
Houchard is in the pay of the English. Last week, we praised Houchard. The committee praised him.
Last week we did not possess the full facts.
The victory of Hanschut, one of our own, and what, this week we throw him to the mob?
Hanschut was not a victory. Although it appeared so at the time.
Anything that smells of less than perfect military success has got to be a form of betrayal. And Houchard actually wanted the other side to win. This is pure Hitler, basically. And General Houchard was, of course, someone who was monstrously awful to Robespierre because he was actually a working-class person. He was sort of sans-culotte general.
Houchard, his military victory now reclassified as a defeat, was instantly relieved of his command. And within a week, his bewildered head was under the blade of a guillotine.
Robespierre had always been ambivalent on the subject of violence, and he would say to his opponents, show me where I have ever acted outside the law. And yet, right from the beginning, right from the Bastille days, he had spoken of the necessity of revolutionary violence. Those early lynch mobs he had justified as perpetrating a form of revolutionary justice.
What I was shocked at when I read at least some of Robespierre's writing was his ruthless honesty. How, for example, he openly says, I am well aware that if you look at the immediate, I paraphrase him now, of course, the immediate reality of what we are doing, we are killing people, we are doing monstrosities and so on. And he said, the only thing that justifies it is the idea of equality, revolutionary ideal, virtue, and so on and so on. He had no illusions here.
What sure judgment can one make of the effects which follow these great commotions? Who can mark
after the event, the exact point at which the waves of popular insurrection should break. To make those who revolt criminally responsible would be to punish them for their devotion. At that price, what people could ever shake off the yoke of despotism?
This, the revolutionary dilemma, the calculated act of violence to speed human history on its way. For Robespierre, it was simple. Do you want, he asked, a revolution without a revolution?
Yes, you want the American Revolution. That's a revolution with a revolution, but doesn't become a tyranny. It's as simple as that. There's nothing unrevolutionary about the American Revolution.
Isn't this, I claim, the same logic? The fundamental feature of our late capitalist society. We want what? We want a product, an object, without paying the harsh price for it. We want beer without alcohol. We want chocolate without sugar. We want coffee without caffeine. We want the thing without the harsh element. And even in politics, what was, you remember, the Colin Powell doctrine? War, but with all this shock and awe bombing, without any casualties on our side. War without war.
I can't believe people would want to ever defend that position. My favourite quote is Saint-Just saying, the Republic consists in the extermination of all who oppose it. In other words, the point of the revolution is slaughtering anyone who might disagree with the government at that moment in time. That is what Robespierre and Saint-Just are all about. They're excited by the possibility of a great and general bloodletting, out of which the new perfect man may come.
What followed in the winter of 1793 was one of the major purges of the terror, characteristically packaged by Robespierre in a wrapping of intense self-congratulation.
Citizen people's representatives, you have before your eyes Europe's record and your own. And already you can form a conclusion from it that the universe has an interest in our conservation. Which of us does not feel his faculties enlarged? Which of us does not feel himself raised above humanity itself on reflecting that we are not just for one people, but for the universe, for the men alive today, but for those who will exist? In the world we are creating, all people will become a single people of brothers, and you would have as many friends as there are men on earth. But it is time to teach the imbeciles who are unaware of it and the perverts who pretend to doubt it that the French Republic exists. You can feel a legitimate pride. Congratulate yourselves on having annihilated royalty and punished kings, overthrown the idols on whom the world grovelled. But above all else, for running the blade of the law against the criminal heads that rose among you.
That's one of the psychological crunch points which drives the terror onwards, is the sense that they're being stopped from doing something wonderful, something good for everybody, by this persistent opposition, by all these enemies that continuously emerge from the woodwork. They could be doing so much. They could be creating a reign of virtue. They could be making heaven on earth. You know, that does drive them closer and closer towards the idea that really the only solution is a total extermination of their enemies, wherever they may be found.
In a permanent emergency, the constitution suspended until the peace, that might never come. It might come in our son's time, in our grandson's time, who cares? It's more fun and clearer and more invigorating to do the killing than it is to have philosophical debates about whether it's right to do so.
Tobriso.
The stinking rat.
Briso. Houchard. Dufriche Falaise. D'Orléans. Roland. Verguignon. Condorcet. Isnard. Boileau. Claviat. Barbaro. Bouzeau. Pétion. Rabot de Saint-Étienne. Zinoviev. Bukharin. Kamenev. Radek. Rykov. Rakovsky.
The execution of the Briso faction led one deputy to call the convention the most dangerous place in France. But he was wrong. Lyon had a better claim to that. Couthon had left now and Collot was there to finish the job of purifying the city.
Well, let's go get in there!
He has to make Carthage in some ways of Lyon. He has to go in there with a sense of destruction, so extreme, almost without historical precedent, that will make such an impact on the rest of France that no one will dare do what Lyon has done.
Citizen Robespierre, those fears for the suffering fatherland which determined me to come here at your suggestion were not misplaced. We have created two new tribunals to judge the traitors. As you say, it is necessary that Lyon shall no longer exist.
You could be executed for very, very little, essentially. What was crucial was numbers rather than guilt or innocence in that sort of situation.
I cannot wait for the conspirators to be liquidated. The impatience of the sovereign people thrills through my fibres and heart. Take care of your health, my friend. It is precious to Republicans.
They do a horrible thing later in the autumn when they don't think things are going fast enough. They think they can do better if they use artillery. And they literally chain dozens of people together and herd them out and fire cannon at them.
But it didn't work very well, and so they had to be finished off by soldiers with bayonets. And after a while, the soldiers revolted. They wouldn't kill people in that way. It was just too horrible. So they had to revert to the normal methods.
2,000 people were massacred in Lyon. Republicans, but of the wrong type. In Paris, the idealists on the Committee of Public Safety now had to come to terms with what happens when sadists are given a license to run free.
So many great villains bit the dust today in the area of Brotteaux. What majesty, what a cement for the Republic.
Can a nation only regenerate itself in a bloodbath?
George?
We count the dead who hate liberty. We record their names. Show me the names of the men and women who die of poverty under tyrants. Tell me the names of the thousands who die in humiliating postures on their battlefields.
And what is the present generation compared with the eons to come? cement for the Republic.
Hello? You are not happy with us.
Thoreau was expelled from the committee by the end of the month and condemned as an aristocrat. He would go to the guillotine in Germinal.
You had some revolutionaries who claimed, I can tell a counter-revolutionary just by looking at him. And I think that people feared that Robespierre could see into their hearts.
It's frightening, but wait a minute, these are frightening things. Again, now, sorry, don't take it too personally, but the one who says frightening wants a revolution without a revolution. Oh my God, now I would like to no, it's a bad joke, but you know, if you were in France, yeah, just a little bit. You know?
What is our aim?
It is the use of the Constitution for the benefit of the people.
Who is likely to oppose us?
The rich and the corrupt.
The rich and the corrupt.
What method will they employ?
Slander and hypocrisy.
Slander and hypocrisy.
What are the factors that will encourage their use?
The ignorance of the sans-culottes. The people, therefore, must be instructed.
What are the obstacles to their enlightenment?
The paid journalists who mislead the people every day by shameless distortions.
The paid journalists who mislead the people with shameless distortions.
What conclusion follows?
That we ought to proscribe these writers as the most dangerous enemies of the country and to circulate an abundance of good literature.
What other obstacle is there to their instruction?
Their destitution.
Destitution.
When then will the people be educated?
When they have enough bread to eat. When the rich and the government stop bribing treacherous pens and tongues to deceive them, and instead identify their own interests with those of the people.
When will this be?
Never.
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 It's interesting that that's a private document. It's not something he published. He didn't stand up in front of the convention and say, when will that time come? Never. And quite possibly if he had, he would have been accused of counter-revolutionary activity in his own right.
All authentic revolutionaries were always deeply suspicious about the final result. So this never of Robespierre's. He was well aware that the struggle goes on forever, so that it's almost a kind of a oriental wisdom that the only satisfaction that we can get is the satisfaction of the struggle itself.
I think it's the expression of the pessimism that has been with him since before the revolution started. A terrifying feeling that he carries inside. That the whole enterprise is doomed and their efforts will be ploughed under and forgotten as revolutions have been ever since the beginning of the world.
There is a paradox for those who believe the terror was a byproduct of war. Towards the end of 1793, the French armies were winning, both in the south, where the British were kicked out of Toulon, and north, where the Austrians were expelled from French soil. And yet the violence of the state was becoming more intense than ever. Much of it was now directed towards de-Christianization, the forcible eviction of religious belief from French life by state-sponsored armed gangs.
They would dress farmyard animals up in clerical vestments. They would make priests ride backwards on a donkey through the streets. They would dress up themselves in clerical vestments and then, you know, get drunk and smash up churches. And it's grievously insulting in the end, even to someone like Robespierre, who doesn't believe in the structures of Catholicism, but believes that out-and-out atheism is immoral.
One of the most enthusiastic de-Christianizers was Collot d'Herbois. At the end of 1793, he left Lyon and raced back to Paris to defend himself against Robespierre.
Robespierre was trying to crack down on this, and Collot felt very threatened by that. He was afraid that Robespierre had him on the list of people to be arrested.
You've gone soft, Robespierre. Didn't know you liked priests.
I like the priests no more than you do. But I don't ever remember advising Jacobins to line them up in public and force them to piss into the communion cup.
Oh, you should leave Paris and see more of France. The crowd was cheering.
You're persuaded by that, are you? All you're doing is making hypocrites.
That's funny, Robespierre. I had the strong feeling my men were making revolutionaries.
Remind me again where I said that revolutionaries must be atheists.
You. You.
Everyone likes to win. It was just Robespierre's way of winning was something that people didn't understand. And the question becomes, actually, who can speak for patriotism? Who is the perfect patriot? Who is in possession of the knowledge of what it means to be revolutionary?
At the start of 1794, Robespierre took a gigantic step to claiming that knowledge. In a speech to the convention, he laid bare both his love of humanity and his readiness to kill for it.
Weaknesses, vices, prejudice, these pave the high road to monarchy. We want to substitute in our country morality for egotism, probity for a mere sense of honour, principle for habit, the empire of reason for the tyranny of custom, the charm of happiness for the tedium of pleasure, the grandeur of humanity for the triviality of grand society. We want, in a word, to fulfill nature's desires, to fulfill the destiny of humanity, and complete the promises of philosophy.
The temptation to want to recreate the human species in some more morally refined version goes all the way back to Rousseau, and a sense in which really power is a form of moral schooling. Robespierre was extremely keen on that. And I think there's nothing wrong with that, providing you may sitting in a classroom voluntary, really. But Robespierre held it, like as did Mao Zedong in the Cultural Revolution, and you know, the Komsomol, all dictators who've attempted to kind of die stamp the heterogeneity of regular human beings with what they take to be the optimum set of moral values.
If the mainspring of popular government in peacetime is virtue, amid revolution, it is virtue and terror. Virtue without which terror is cruel. Terror without which virtue is impotent. Terror is nothing but prompt, severe, inflexible justice. Is therefore the emanation of virtue.
Literally, terror is an emanation of virtue. That is to say, in a radical situation of injustice, the only actual proof of love is to accept to fight, to accept the struggle. That's for me the lesson of it, and it's simply true. We shouldn't be afraid of it. Jesus Christ says precisely the same thing. when he at the same time says love, turn the left cheek and all that stuff. And then he says, you remember, if you don't hate your mother, your father, you are not my follower. When he says, I bring sword, war, destruction, I don't bring peace, and so on and so on. It's as simple as that. This is the radical emancipatory logic which one should accept.
The blade began dropping with tedious regularity after Robespierre's speech on virtue. But in the spring of 1794, a campaign for clemency and political amnesty was launched to reflect France's improved military situation. The man leading the campaign was the Jacobin journalist Camille Desmoulins, hero of the storming of the Bastille and an intimate of Robespierre's.
They'd been friends since their childhood. They'd been at school together. If there was anyone who had worked his way through the chinks of Robespierre's armour, it was Camille Desmoulins. Robespierre was godfather to his son. And Camille was out of control. He was a loose cannon. You didn't know what he was going to say next.
Camille had started a newspaper, the Old Cordelier. Robespierre had read proofs of the first two editions, but number three was different.
I did not wish to wake you.
I was not asleep.
The incendiary paper was brought to Robespierre when he was ill.
You will not know what your friend has done. Camille has done something very stupid. Maxime, Camille has done something...
very stupid, yes.
He's grown a little fond of Tacitus.
Camille said, this week I'm simply going to give you a classical translation. I'm going to present to you passages from the reign of Tiberius. Painting a picture of ancient Rome in the days of oppression and terror.
Once words have become crimes against the state, from there it was only one step to turn into crimes mere looks. Sadness, compassion, sighs, even silence. Mamasus was guilty of counter-revolution for having written a tragedy in which a certain verse was capable of two interpretations. The mother of the consul Fusius was guilty of counter-revolution for having wept over the death of her son. People feared their very fear would make them guilty.
Please tell me you're not enjoying this.
Hey, it's only a translation. I'm not engaging in political controversy. But of course everyone knew exactly where it was aimed.
Everything made the tyrant suspicious. In a word, during these reigns, if a famous man died in his bed, it was a talked about event.
He's been told, you have become all you despised. You have become a dictator. You have become like the bloodiest of Roman emperors.
He enjoys your protection, Maxime. He exploits it. He is encouraged by Danton.
Danton, the inspirational Georges Danton, a revolutionary, a Jacobin, a man also with blood on his hands. Danton had been an early member of the Committee of Public Safety, but now he was defining himself against it and calling for an end to the terror.
At that point, in the spring of 1794, those who were not with them were against them, and so it was a matter of kill or be killed. So once they decide to move against someone like Danton, the material evidence is not the issue. The point is that he had challenged the power of the committees. He had to go. The evidence actually brought against him is thin in the extreme, and a lot of it comes from personal notes about him made by Robespierre about his demeanour.
Made himself ridiculous by crying at the Tribune. He's a sybarite. Called public opinion a harlot. He has a poor attitude of virtue.
Robespierre hated Danton for carrying with him the kind of sweat and smell, the kind of odour of a lived life, really, which Robespierre was very careful never to do.
One of the jokes that Danton apparently made was the only thing he knew about virtue was that he made love to his wife every night. That was the only virtue he knew. And Robespierre did not like jokes about virtue. To him, this was in itself suspect.
He told Robespierre that uprightness was what he showed his wife at night.
He was a friend of the traitor de Maurier. Encouraged Brissot.
We were all friends of de Maurier.
He took money from the English. What Danton will think tomorrow is set for him today by the secret committees of Prussia, England, Austria. Talks incessantly of love of fatherland. But he has an Alp in his mind that represents the past. He cannot see over it. He has not matched the stature of the revolution.
How can a man who's known every kind of immorality be a champion of freedom?
I'm worried you appear to be asking me, citizen.
Why are we still talking about this? If he's guilty, if he threatens the Republic, arrest him.
Let him first hear these charges in the convention. I intend to read them to his face.
Well, that would be stupid.
The trial of Danton, Camille and their followers was a show trial. And like all show trials, it could only have one outcome. A guilty verdict followed by an execution. Famously, Robespierre's windows on St. Honoré remained shuttered that day.
Nobody could believe that Danton hadn't done his best for the revolution. He had been as closely identified with the revolution as Robespierre had been, and that was the problem. This was the first time that Robespierre was sending to the guillotine a close revolutionary colleague and friend.
Where was Robespierre now? He'd lost his early revolutionary self. His radical self. But after Camille's death, he lost his childhood self as well. Who was there now who knew how Robespierre had been in those days?
Camille was buried under quicklime, expunged from the revolutionary script, and the terror took another sickening twist. The month of Prairial, 1794, the pasture month. Forgiveness is barbarity, Robespierre was now saying. Tolerance is atrocity. At the end of the month, he called the committee together to prove it.
I think you will find that this is the document in order, as discussed, George.
The law of 22nd Prairial introduced the thought crime to European history. State prosecutors were encouraged to decipher people's faces and read their minds for signs of dissent. Juries were instructed to convict on instinct. The right to defence was removed.
All in favour, say aye.
Virtue needed no defence.
Aye.
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 The idea that's animating Robespierre, Saint-Just, Couthon really is that they can't trust anyone. By May of 1794, you do have to start thinking in terms of terms like paranoia. They lose any kind of critical focus. They are executing people in batches after the barest sketch of a trial on evidence from informers within the prisons who are basically venal or making things up to keep themselves alive, to earn small amounts of money.
The accusations flooded in to meet the new demand, and the police files grew into an enormous bureaucracy serviced by spies. The result was Robespierre's own police bureau, where he and his staff ploughed through the endless denunciations to discover what was happening in France. But like any system relying on denunciation, the more evidence it generated, the less it reflected reality. And the more it reflected ruined or terminated lives.
What he feared was the clandestine, the plot, the secret list, the underhand agenda, the conspiracy. Are the actors in the great revolutionary drama, are they in fact wearing masks? The revolution talks a lot about masks and veils and pulling aside the masks and what horrible thing you might find if you dared to pull aside the mask. Would he find himself standing on a desolate plain as the only perfect revolutionary left alive?
In June, this corrupt thought that Robespierre was the revolution began to acquire wings. The occasion was the Festival of the Supreme Being, a mass rally organized in Paris to pay homage to the divine hand which was said to be guiding the revolution.
It's essentially his idea. And the whole festival is staged on Pentecost, staged on the day of a great traditional religious festival, but replaced with a celebration of this supreme being. But what is seen by many at the time is really a celebration of Robespierre.
Let us be grave and discreet in our deliberations, as men who determine the course of the world. Let us be ardent and stubborn in our wrath against the confederated tyrants. Let us crush the wicked line of kings, more so by the greatness of our character than by force of arms.
Behold, liberty!
Many observers remark on how much he's enjoying himself. He seems to be soaking in this artificial atmosphere of religious devotion they've created.
We'll never know how many people really believed in the cult of the Supreme Being, because again, as in sort of Soviet Russia or Communist China, people are kind of dragooned, you know. You can always round up enough adorable 11-year-old girls and drape them in white and shove a wheat sheaf in their hand. It's more than literally your life's worth not to seem keen on this sort of public veneration.
He's clearly having a wonderful time, while various sceptical deputies are remarking that, you know, he's turning himself into God.
Yeah, for the grace of God goes God.
It's one of the moments when a backlash starts amongst the political establishment itself against his leading role, that he is starting to go too far.
The opposition swelled again when Robespierre's police arrested officers close to Lazare Carnot.
Of course, we always get the wrong man.
Conscience. Conscience. Divine instinct. Immortal voice from heaven. Infallible judge of good and evil, making man like to God. Rousseau. Man's duty, man's right to follow his conscience.
Well, the plural of conscience is conspiracy.
You see a bunch of heads in a basket and you see a conspiracy. See how intimate they are, how furtive they look. How do you know a denunciation is true?
And what do you think all this is, hmm?
We see a man strapped to a board with a blade above his head and we say, there is evidence. He must be guilty, or he wouldn't be there.
What would you have us do, Carnot?
when we are nearly there.
Fall back into bad habits and imperil the Republic again? He who undertakes to create a people must see himself involved, so to speak, in changing human nature.
So to speak?
Your point?
Oh, we could argue about Rousseau all day, Maxime, and still not agree. He argued with himself for a lifetime.
Well, of course, we don't have that luxury.
Precisely.
Innocence never fears public scrutiny, Carnot. He who trembles at this moment is guilty.
He takes fear to be an index of evil deeds. And the innocent man should be unabashed in the face of accusation. And yet he must have known that it is very easy to induce panic and shame in people.
There is a moment of truth when Robespierre brings, I think, on stage a black book and then says, I have here a list of traitors, no? And then turns up and says, if, I paraphrase him, if any of you now feels fear that his name, is afraid that his name is in my book, this already is a proof that he is a traitor. I claim there is a deep truth in it.
That the innocent person really can never be afraid of monsters, secret policemen, who can kind of torture them and, you know, actually extract lies out of them and then execute them without any right to defence. Why the hell would you not be afraid? Long live trembling.
Thermidor, the month of Robespierre's demise. For 3 whole weeks, he'd failed to attend the Committee of Public Safety, leaving his enemies space to doubt and time to rally. His speeches had also become more personal, more apocalyptic.
He said in his speech to the convention, "What objection can be made to a man who wishes to speak the truth and is prepared to die for it? And in the end, that to him was the guarantee of his own probity."
He said that a true revolutionary should accept that if necessary, he will perish himself in the process. And then he says openly, "I in advance accepted that I may die in the process." It's something very beautiful that he says that. He's not saying I am pure. He's saying maybe the process will swallow me. You know this usual motto, revolution eats its own children. Robespierre was ready to accept this. I will be eaten. That's the true heroism.
Do you remember the sugar riots? Such anger over a paltry thing.
Paris was short of food, Maxime.
But sugar loaves? The people rise up against the grocers, but they keep the conspirators in place. Are they good enough?
Well, the stones are cut for freedom. You can build a palace from those stones. Or a tomb.
I am so tired.
We must force the people to be free.
Strategically, Robespierre made some very obvious mistakes. He hinted that he was about to issue another of these lists of the proscribed, but then he didn't do it. And somebody challenged him and said, "Name names."
Suicidally, he fails to name exactly who he has in mind, but he's made it clear that no one is safe. We have a number of people who are members of the Assembly, and they write that evening to their friends in the provinces, things like, "Tomorrow, either I'll be dead or Robespierre will be dead."
On the morning of the 27th of July, 9 Thermidor, Robespierre and Saint-Just came to the Tribune for the last time.
Everyone then knows that things are going to get ugly, and they assume that Saint-Just and Robespierre will stand together. They assume there will be some sort of coup d'etat.
The course of events indicates that this rostrum Maybe the Tarpeian rock for the man.
He hardly gets a word out. He's shouted down and he just goes completely quiet. And I think he is absolutely stunned. I just don't think there's any way that he knows what's going on or knows what's the right way to react.
Robespierre thinks he is going to be able to stand up in front of the convention and explain what he has done for the revolution, and that members of the convention will be swayed.
Listen to me! Listen to me!
He kept attempting to deliver this very elaborate speech that he had prepared, and people would speak over him or boo him. And in one case, somebody shouting,
"The blood of Danton chokes him!"
It's the blood of Danton that chokes you.
I would love to have been there. Dictators like Mao and Stalin die annoyingly in their beds, not confronted with the sudden disintegration of their charisma. It was an amazing moment, actually. Suddenly, what seemed to be insurmountable happens like that. People suddenly have the kind of aura of invincibility stripped from them.
Robespierre and Saint-Just, along with Couthon, were arrested by the convention. But when soldiers faithful to Robespierre engineered their release, the three men found themselves faced with a profound decision. Should they launch a coup d'état? And if so, under whose name?
By escaping from arrest, as they had done, they have put themselves outside the law. They've made themselves illegal. And therefore, in his own mind, they have no base. And I think he's paralysed by that.
What's wrong? But under whose name?
He is completely ineffectual. It's the most ineffectual day in his life, probably. And they say, well, who should it be in the name of? Should it be in the name of the convention, the French people? He hasn't got a clue.
Maxime, we agreed the National Convention. We speak for the convention.
But the convention has ceased to represent the people. I think we sign in the name of the people.
Do you think we should sign in the name of the people?
Eventually, they decide to appeal to the armies in the name of the people itself. They have completely identified themselves with the popular will, with the general will. But they are just a small group of men trapped in a room in the city hall.
Make way! Convention soldiers!
You're under arrest!
Speech had always been his weapon. And his jaw was shot away. He could no longer utter a coherent word. We'd come to the end of speech and the end of being listened to. I think he must have cut such a pathetic and helpless figure at that stage that even his enemies may have been moved by his plight.
Oh, you can feel sorry for anybody who's about to die. You know, you can feel sorry for Joseph Stalin expiring of a stroke on his sofa and people being too afraid to go near him. But it's your ability to feel sorry for them is what makes you different from them.
Who'd have thought He's outlived his mouth.
The schism in the modern world is between those who feel that their version of truth demands that it be enforced, and those who feel that the only right you have is to make your case to people who are then left alone to agree or not agree. Our job is to make sure that we can disagree without the obligation to exterminate people who don't happen to agree with us.
The great liberal ideas of the French Revolution survived Robespierre's life. But the fundamentalist idea that eternal truths can justify murder survived his death too. The pursuit of virtue through terror has never gone away.